Thanks very much, Phil. Good morning, everybody. Bit of a limp good morning, if I may say so. Just give the person next to you a bit of a Christian slap, just to make sure they're still... Just a Christian slap. And the other person on the other side, we don't want them to miss out now, do we? All right, let's try again. Good morning, everybody. So much better. Well done. Well, it's been great to be with you. Thank you so much for the invitation and opportunity to share with you in this 24 hours. It really has been great. Before I preached, however, today, I do feel that I need to confess a sin. Would you lean forward slightly, because this is quite difficult for me. So just lean forward slightly. Some of you are saying, I will not lean forward. Lean forward. I often am covetous of other people's hair. I used to have hair. It stuck out like Florida. Children and small animals would shelter neath its shade. Now I have a shrinking peninsula. My hairstyle is that of an alarmed baby eagle. I often covet people's hair, but during my time with you, Salt and Light, I confess humbly before the Lord that I have been coveting Pete James's head. Not only is this man a brilliant worship leader, but for one, hirsutically challenged. It's a Greek term. He has the perfect shape. Stand up, Pete. Stand up. Stand. Look at that perfect noggin. Look at that. Brilliant. So, feel so much better now. That's good. Once again, it is God's will that you buy books. So please stop wrestling in the valley of decision. Surrender, my people. And seriously, the books are out there. In fact, we're only going to be here through lunchtime, and so this special deal we've got going on will be gone when we're gone. We have to take the books with us. Faith in the Fog, a book about the message I shared last night based on this book. But if you want to explore that a lot more, get this. Really honest stuff about burnout and disappointment and depression too. It doesn't sound very exciting, but I think we need honest conversations in the church. This book just came out a few months ago. It's called The Cactus Stabbers. It's based on some of the incredible people that I've met in my millions of miles of travels. I've traveled about 3 million miles in ministry. That's why I look like I do. I'm only 23, but all this... And I don't know whether you can see the cover, any of you. It's a cactus with a pair of glasses. And I said to the publisher, what's that about? And she said, it looks like you. So pray for me as I look for a new publisher. That would be good. And then There Are No Ordinary People, the story of Barnabas doing ordinary life beautifully. I really want to see that unlocked in the church. I love it when spectacular things happen, but as we live each day, the ordinary life can be done beautifully. You buy any 3 books, you get Lucas on Life free. We take checks, credit cards, chickens, anything really. So those are available. I want to thank the Salt and Light team for very graciously enabling me to take 120 seconds this morning to just mention the work of Compassion. I'm an international ambassador for Compassion. I've traveled to Ethiopia and to India to see the work that they're doing around the world, changing the lives of children. Those children grow up and they look back on the not just the life-changing work of Compassion, but actually the life-saving work of Compassion. Why don't you take a look at the video screen and look at the work of Compassion for a moment.
My earliest recollections is finding myself at the age of 5, roaming the streets, eating from dumpsters.
We were forced to live with 17 of our other relatives in a very small shanty.
If you want to be out of poverty, then you have to deal with drugs.
My friends were actually sold into prostitution.
Kids dying for preventable causes.
And as darkness engulfs the place, the devil takes over.
My relatives would always tell me, Michelle, you are so ugly. You will become nothing but a thief and a drug addict when you grow up. And those were the words that I heard from people whom I expected to love and take care of me.
I watched as my 10-month-old sister died in the laps of my mother out of starvation.
But right in the middle of this desperation, it was then that compassion intervened. What joy and dancing came to my home at the news that I'd finally got a sponsor.
I received my first letter.
We wrote back and forth. She said words like, Richmond, I love you.
And that lightened me up.
My sponsor told me, Michelle, you are beautiful. You are precious to us, and we love you. And her words touched the very depth of my heart and soul.
18 years later, here I am, a child rescued from hopelessness.
My name is Michelle.
My name is Tony.
My name is Jimmy.
My name is Richmond.
And one act saved my life.
And one act
saved my life.
Saved my life.
Will you act?
The choice is yours.
Sponsor a child through compassion today.
Release a child from poverty.
From poverty. In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Very often we look around our world and we see so much pain and we say there's nothing that we can do. There is something that we can do. It costs £25 a month to sponsor a child with compassion. And Kay and I, our experience has been not only the blessing of seeing lives change, but our own family impacted by being in communication with those young people as through the years we've been able to sponsor them. Your children will be impacted by those photographs on the refrigerator and those letters that you receive. One of the challenges about being a Christian is that you can always put things off by saying, well, we've been thinking about that, but we'll just pray about it for the next 30 or 40 years and never actually get round to it. Well, as a way of saying thank you, because there are children like Genesis from Nicaragua who are waiting to be sponsored, as a way of saying thank you, I write daily Bible reading notes. And if you would like to sign up with Compassion, their table is next to our bookstore. They'll give you a free one-year subscription to those notes. Two young ladies came to me in Southport recently, both unemployed. And they said, we can't afford to sponsor by ourselves. Can we get together and do this? I was very impacted by that decision. Can I just say one other thing? And that is, tonight there is this really strategic and important offering that you as a Salt and Light family are taking. I'm so grateful to the team here for allowing me to talk about compassion. If there is any choice between the two, and I hope that there isn't, please do not go to compassion. Please invest in the offering that is being taken in your own network. But this is not an offering, this is sponsorship, and I'd invite you to make that decision. We'll be over there, and we'd love to answer any questions that you have. Now, you've been sitting down for a while, and that's a bit worrying, so why don't you stand for a moment if you're able, please. Just stand for a moment if you're able. Have a little stretch. I've got this new exercise video coming out soon. It's called You Two Can Have a Body Like Mine If You're Not Careful. Why don't you turn around and say hello to those two or three people you've been hoping to avoid? Go ahead. All right, this is verging on fun, and we can't have that. So please turn back around. Have a seat. The last person to sit down can take us all out for lunch, which I've just realized is probably going to be me. If you have a Bible, I'd like you to turn with me, please, to Acts chapter 11 as we talk about radical disciples, healthy church. Acts chapter 11, and I would like to read to you from verse 19. Acts 11, verse 19. The Bible says this. Now those who'd been scattered by the persecution that broke out when Stephen was killed traveled as far as Phoenicia, Cyprus, and Antioch, spreading the word only among Jews. Some of them, however, men from Cyprus and Cyrene, went to Antioch and began to speak to Greeks also, telling them the good news about the Lord Jesus. The Lord's hand was with them, and a great number of people believed and turned to the Lord. News of this reached the church in Jerusalem, and they sent Barnabas to Antioch. And when he arrived and saw what the grace of God had done, he was glad and encouraged them all to remain true to the Lord with all their hearts. He was a good man, full of the Holy Spirit and faith, and a great number of people were brought to the Lord. Then Barnabas went to Tarsus to look for Saul, and when he found him, he brought him to Antioch. So for a whole year, Barnabas and Saul met with the church and taught great numbers of people. The disciples were called Christians first at Antioch. I spend a lot of my time in Christian gatherings. We're leaving here today, speaking somewhere else on Saturday and somewhere else on Sunday, and so the summer season of Christian events continues. And 99% of the time, I really enjoy myself, and I love the worship. I've really enjoyed worshiping with you here in this time. Can I just be ever so honest with you and say, I don't always enjoy it. Have you ever been in one of those Christian gatherings where the worship seems eternal? And you sing the same song 49 times. And you're just about to get onto a conference call with the Samaritans, losing the will to live. When suddenly the enthusiastic worship leader says, do you know heaven's going to be just like this? Only longer. I spend a lot of time in Christian gatherings, so it's a bit naughty, another confession of sin. It's a bit naughty, but I quite like it when things go a bit wrong in Christian gatherings. When it's all carefully planned and then it all gets a bit lashed up. I know it's naughty, but it can be slightly entertaining. Like in one church that I could mention, I won't tell you where the church is in case you're from Belfast, Northern Ireland. But I was in this church. I won't tell you who the leader of the church is in case you know Paul Reed. And I was just about to get up to speak, and Paul Reed got up before introducing me. He said, by the way, he said, we need to pray for the ladies of our church. He said, a lot of our ladies are away this weekend at a big women's conference. Now, I struggled to not emit a titter. My imagination running wildfire. And then he made it really worse because he said, you know, they're at Gatwick Airport at the moment. They've had a bit of problem with their luggage. So we need to pray that the bags get home safely. Oh, yes, I cried. Amen. Bring those bags home. I like it when things go a little bit wrong in church. And I love it when things go really right in church life. 25 years ago, Timberline Church in Fort Collins, Colorado, where I am a teaching pastor there, a happy family church of 200 or 300 people, one weekend everything went right, which was the pivotal moment, the junction moment that changed everything and means that now the church is somewhere around 5,000 to 10,000, depending on how you count. Everything changed one weekend when Nikki came to church. Nikki, a brilliant, beautiful law student, also working part-time as a stripper in a local dance club, came to church. Christian leaders often ask me, what's the key to church growth? I'm tempted to say, get a stripper in. How wrong that would be. Nikki used to have her hair cut and her nails done by Larry. Larry is a fantastic evangelist. Larry's also a hairdresser. Hairdressers make good evangelists. They've got a captive audience and they're armed. So Larry used to talk to Nikki about Jesus and she said, can I come to your church? She came to church one Sunday morning. Get the picture here. She did not come dressed for church. Not an item manufactured by Laura Ashley was about her person. She just came to church dressed for work. Came and sat on the front row, kept nudging Larry. Why is the preacher talking about me? Shh, he said, shh, listen. At the end of the service, she gave her life to Jesus. That's good, isn't it? 3 days later, she phoned our senior leader, Pastor Darry. He was a bit surprised. He doesn't get that many calls from strippers. Hello, she said, I became a Christian last Sunday. He said, that's excellent. She said, I've read the New Testament. He said, which part? She said, the whole thing. She read the whole New Testament in 3 days. She said, I figured out that Jesus doesn't want me to take my clothes off for stupid, leering men. Am I right? He said, you're right. She said, I'll give it up then. She went to the strip club. She gathered her friends. By the way, these were not bad people. These were her loving community, this strip club. She said, I've got to leave. They wept. They cried. She invited them to her baptism. They closed the strip club down for Nikki's baptism. I've got a picture in my mind. It's a fantasy, but I've got a picture in my mind. No, don't go there. Of a notice on the door that said, strip club cancelled due to baptism. 18 of her friends came to her baptism, including the bouncers who wore their yellow fluorescent jackets with the name of the club on because they were upset with us for taking their Nikki away. 18 of them came down the center aisle, the women with slits up their skirts and all kinds of things showing everywhere. Some of our ladies were actually covering their husbands' eyes. 35 men volunteered for the greeting team immediately. At the end of that service, 11 of them became Christians. It was amazing. It was fantastic. It was incredible. And it was hideous. Because now you see, it's not, we get all excited if really naughty people, as we perceive them, show up at church. The problem is if they stay. What we had to become was a healthy, missional church as these surprising people flooded into the kingdom. 2,000 years ago in a city called Antioch, there was another influx, another surprise from God as unexpected people were flooding into the kingdom. Antioch, the third largest city in the Roman Empire with a population of around 500,000, a marble-paved high street, 4 miles long, a beautiful, cosmopolitan, pagan city where they worshipped a god, strangely, called Daphne. I mean, with apologies to Daphnes everywhere, it's not normally a name you'd give to a god, is it? It's like worshipping Harold, which would really mess up our worship songs, wouldn't it? Daphne is worshipped. It's the New York City of the day. But it is there that we discover a healthy, healthy church. Ladies and gentlemen, I am convinced that what we need today is not just big churches, but we need healthy churches. It is possible to have a large church that is healthy. It is possible, particularly in a rural situation, to have a small church that is healthy. It is possible to have a large church that is unhealthy. It is possible to have a small church that is unhealthy. What we need is not just big or small, but healthy. So what does that look like? Let's take a look at Antioch. First of all, let's see this. A healthy church with healthy disciples is a church that is confident about church. Barnabas and Saul met with the church, it says in chapter 11, verse 25. Now in the church in Antioch, it says in Acts 13, 1, there is a church that is formed there. I don't know very much about the history of Salt and Light, but my knowledge of some of the friends that I have here says to me that you are a network, you are a family who have believed for the last 40 years in the vital significance of the local church. I believe that you have not stepped away from that when other movements have diluted their ecclesiology. I think we need to reaffirm our belief in the vital significance of our being together. You see, a survey was taken in America recently asking, how often does the average American Christian go to some kind of church activity? And the answer is 1.5 times a month. An American pastor friend of mine said, Jeff, what's happened to us? 30 years ago, we were together 3 times a week. Now it's 1.5 times a month. What is happening is that there has been a systematic erosion in the understanding that we have concerning the importance of togetherness and community. We're a selfie culture. We individualize everything. It's all about me. I touched on that last night. We even individualize the way that we read the Bible. And so, for example, when we read the word you in the New Testament, the second person singular, and we read the word you in the New Testament, the second person plural, it's the same word in the English. So I read you and I think me. Whereas often the New Testament is not just writing to me, but is writing to us together. That's why my friends in Oklahoma have got it right, because they talk about y'all. Y'all. We need, I am convinced, to rediscover a widescreen ecclesiology, a biblical understanding of the importance of gathered community. Philip Yancey, in his customary brilliance in his latest book, Vanishing Grace, someone said to him, how can you summarize the entire message of the Bible in one sentence? And Yancey said this, God gets his family back. It starts, the story starts with a family in Eden. And it ends in the book of Revelation with a family marching together into eternity. And the story in between is about God getting his family back. Ladies and gentlemen, the church is not just about me and my needs and my preferences. It's about being part of what Bishop Tom Wright calls the big fat story of God. In Genesis chapter 2, we see that gathered family, and we see the fall of humanity and the first murder in Genesis 4. We see primeval history descending down to Genesis chapter 11, when the first humanistic community was created, the Tower of Babel. Let's banish God. Let's build a tower for ourselves. And God scattered that community and confused the languages. And right there in Genesis chapter 12, God's new kingdom family project is birth in the call of Abraham and the ultimate gathering and creation of Israel, a community to live on earth and show what life lived with God could actually look like. And they got legalistic and they backslid and they forgot who they were. And the prophets kicked them and nudged them. And then the prophets prophesy about the one who is to come. And Jesus comes. And he comes not just to live and die, but to show us the way of the kingdom. And he goes to the cross to deal with every barrier that separates us from God. And on the third day, he is raised again to life. And he spends 6 weeks with his apostles, giving them the principles again of the kingdom. And then the day of Pentecost arrives, when they're all together in one place. And there's a sound of rushing mighty wind. And suddenly, ladies and gentlemen, look at this. The curse of Genesis 11, the confusion of languages, is reversed. And now everybody understands the good news in their own tongue. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the church. We are part of it. It's a massive, massive privilege. A survey was taken. They said, what three sentences do you most like to hear? What three sentences do you most like to hear? Predictably, the primary response, the number one thing that people like to hear is simply this: I love you. The second thing that people most like to hear is, I forgive you. And the third sentence that people most like to hear, according to the survey, I love you, I forgive you, supper's ready. Think about it. That's the gospel of the kingdom. God saying, I love you, I forgive you, supper's ready. Come and be part of the community of God. And can I say that that fellowship has shape? It's not just about popping down to the coffee shop and having a little chat about Jesus. In the New Testament, fellowship has apostolic shape with leadership, discipline, communion, baptism, teaching, corporate prayer, fasting, salt and light people. Keep holding a high view of the value of church. And don't ever let a virus get in among you that says, we don't need each other. We don't need to gather. Declare together, we believe in the church. Is anyone there? It's a church in Antioch. Secondly, there's everyday confident witness in this church. Everyday confident witness. Some of them, however, men from Cyprus and Cyrene, went to Antioch, began to speak to Greeks also, telling them the good news about the Lord Jesus. Two words used here. One, speaking of proclamation, they proclaimed the gospel. And the other, talking of conversation, they gossiped the gospel. Whatever happened to evangelism? We've done a pendulum swing. We're all pendulums. We think we're balanced. We're not. We're all in reaction to something. When I became a Christian, you wouldn't want to sit next to me on a bus, on a plane, anywhere. I was the world's most enthusiastic evangelist. I had a big badge which said something subtle like, hello, you're going to hell. I had so many fishes on the back of my car, it looked like a mobile aquarium. I would turn every conversation around to Jesus. Would you like a cheese sandwich, Jeff? No, thank you. I have the bread of life. How about you? And I've done a pendulum swing, reacting against that kind of pushy behavior. And then I heard a few preachers quote a famous Christian saint when he said, by all means, preach the gospel. If necessary, use words. And I thought, great, I don't have to use words. Forgetting that the chap who said that was St. Francis of Assisi, famous not only for chatting with passing squirrels, but also for giving everything away to the poor. When you give everything away to the poor, you probably haven't got to say too much. Whatever happened to those times when we got together and said, you know, I had a great chat with Fred at work this week. Pray for him. I think he's pretty close to coming to God. Whatever happened? What's happened to me? I remember once being on an airplane with an evangelist. Do not fly with evangelists. He's sitting to my left. This woman is sitting to my right. I know this woman is nervous. She's eating the in-flight magazine. She's chewing away. We take off. I get a nudge in the ribs from the evangelist friend. Oof. He said, the woman next to you is nervous. I said, brilliant. I can see that she's snacking on the magazine. She's going to start on the headrest any moment. He said, why don't you tell her about Jesus and offer to pray for her? I said, I can't do that. Can't do that. We carried on flying. We hit a patch of turbulence. The woman screamed, ah! The woman next to you just screamed. I said, I know you with the brains of a gerbil. It was indeed in my ear. He said, offer to pray for her. I said, I can't say it. I said, it sounds like a pickup line, doesn't it? Hello? Would you like me to pray for you? For I'm very normal. And then the woman screamed again. We hit another patch of turbulence, and she screamed again, ah, and grabbed my hand and wouldn't let go. Now I'm British. We've not been introduced. The woman next to you is holding your hand. I said, I know, rocket scientist, it is my hand. He said, why don't you offer to pray for her? I said, I'm doing my bit and holding her hand. He said, shall I offer? I said, you offer. He leaned over, he said, excuse me. He said, my friend and I are Christians, looking at me as if to say, perhaps. He said, you're holding his hand. Let's face it, he's not Tom Cruise. You're obviously a little bit alarmed. Would you like us to pray for you? She said, yes, please. Yes. Now, why can't evangelists pray quietly? We're 36,000 feet up, me holding this woman's hand, and suddenly we get this, in the name of Jesus, I rebuke. The whole plane turned around and looked at me, and I'm like, what? Oh, no. Do we need to get our voices back? One of the greatest things you can say to that person who's not a follower of Jesus, one of the greatest things you can say is, do you want to come to church? Do you fancy coming to church? Not so that the speaker can get them, so that you're signaling to the woman or man who's preaching.
We have a pagan in the house. A pagan in the house.
No, just so they can come in from the cold into the warmth of Christian community and eat rich tea biscuits. Do we need to get our voices back? Thirdly, a culture of encouragement. Look at Barnabas here. When he arrived and saw what the grace of God had done, he was glad and encouraged them all to remain true to the Lord with all their hearts. This man, he's such a consistent encourager. Are you an encourager? Do you like to catch people doing something right? I've met Christians who go to church gatherings to get irritated. In fact, another confession of sin. We've only just met, and I hate this. I caught myself doing this recently. I come from a new church background, you know, great, fantastic, non-religious, headbutt the tambourine, love it. Two Christmases ago, we went to our local parish church for the midnight Christmas Eve service. And the vicar, who is a lovely bloke, converted rock and roll singer, but he says everything in a voice a little bit like this. And I was sitting there thinking, why don't he just talk in his normal voice? Because if he did, that might be helpful and a bit more relevant. Instead of ending every sentence by going down like this. And I sat there with my evangelical judgmentalism bristling, just waiting for the sermon, which I knew would be rubbish. And it was brilliant. And here's what I don't want to tell you. Oh, I'm going to say to Kay afterwards, why did I tell him that? It was so brilliant. I was so disappointed. Because I had been proven to be wrong. Are you an encouraging person? Are you a Barnabas in your church? You know, you can change the culture of your church by just catching a few people doing something right next weekend. Go to your leaders. Let them know you appreciate them. Often we treat leaders as if they're all planning a dastardly plot. Why don't you let them know that you like them before they die? I hate the thought of kind of watching my funeral from afar and people saying, no, I think we should have said that earlier. I'd hung around for a while. My friend Darry Northrup, who I work with in Timberline, he's the most encouraging person in the world. He'd put the devil on an alpha course. It's incredible. Can't believe I just said that. If you're listening to this by recording here at the Salt and Light Conference, you just heard that inappropriate comment. May I, Dave Richards, just apologize for my comment. I'm truly, truly, just, Chris is just disgusted with me. And Jeff Lucas just walked out. Darry's good at everything. It's irritating. We were out playing golf. I'm rubbish. Hit the ball. My first shot hit it straight into the lake. He said, great shot, Lucas. I said, what do you mean, great shot? I said, you cheesy, superficial American person. I said, I just hit the ball into the water. He said, Jeff, you just hit the ball. Go on, catch someone doing something right. Fourthly, in this church, there's a mature attitude towards suffering. This church was birthed in pain. They were scattered by the persecution. It was the martyrdom of Stephen that had caused these people to be scattered from Jerusalem, become homeless, lose their businesses, lose family members. So it had been birthed in suffering. And now they're in Antioch, and the suffering continues because it says they were first called Christians in Antioch. And we look at that and we think, oh, that's nice, isn't it? Oh, they called them Christians in Antioch. Maybe they had little fishes on their chariots. No, it was a term of derision. In Antioch, there were a group of fanatical emperor worshippers. They were known as the Augustianoi, an insult. So when the Jesus crowd showed up, they called them the Christianoi. It was a derisory comment. And not only that, but Nero was around. Nero, pathological killer. Historians tell us that he had spots, smelt really bad, fancied himself as a singer and an actor, would perform for hours. So bad was he that women would pretend to give birth in order to be let out of the performance, and men would pretend to die so they could be carried out. Don't even think about it now. But more significantly and terrifyingly, this man was a pathological killer. But I want you to see something so important. The church is birthed in suffering. Suffering continues with insult and derision. Suffering is on the horizon with coming persecution. But look at what it says. It says, but the Lord's hand was upon them. One of Dr. Luke's favorite terms. He uses it three times. Three times positively, the hand of the Lord with, one time negatively, the hand of the Lord against. He loves that phrase. I want you to see this. They're suffering, but there's no sense of abandonment by God. In the midst of their suffering, the approval and the blessing of God is upon them. I don't know much about suffering, and I don't want to know. The worst thing that ever happened to me, I think, is a few years ago, I got acute pneumonia, nearly died. I was in a restaurant in London, halfway through the meal. I got swine flu. It wasn't on the menu, but I got it. Turned into pneumonia. I got really ill. I put it on Facebook that I was sick. Some people put on Facebook, you are not sick. You just think you're sick. Great, thanks. I'm sure I am, because I was just throwing up. But some people went into immediate spiritual warfare on Facebook. Satan, we rebuke you! Capital letters, exclamation mark, exclamation mark, exclamation mark. I mean, I didn't even know Satan was on Facebook. And you can imagine all those demons in hell going, ooh, capital letters on Facebook, eh? Exclamation marks too. Didn't see that one coming, boys. Someone said, you're sick. You've not been healed because you haven't got enough faith. Some of you have been told this. Oh, thanks a lot. I was just throwing up, but now I'm an unbelieving vomiter. Excellent. Excellent. Someone else said, you must have sin in your life. Excellent. Thank you. I'm now an unbelieving, vomiting, naughty person. Someone else said, it's probably something in your past. Your great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-grandfather did something really dodgy, and now you're suffering the consequences. Thank you so much. I'll dig him up and slap him. Am I suggesting that all of these things cannot affect our health? Of course I am not. But can I just say this? Let's not rush in with our slogans, with our well-intentioned desire to give a solution. We end up filling in the blanks that God has not filled in. Let's be quicker to pray and stand with and love and slower to rush to a diagnosis. Well, the last thing I want to say is this. Time has gone. And that is simply this. There's ongoing grace shared without fuss. Ongoing grace shared without fuss. Did you notice something here? Because in verse 19, it says those who've been scattered by the persecution in connection with Stephen. Verse 25 says, then Barnabas went to Tarsus to look for Saul. Look at me, everyone. Who's primarily the architect, as far as Luke is concerned, of the persecution in connection with Stephen? Who was that? That would be Saul. People are now in Antioch. Saul, after an initial bout of preaching and a bit of persecution, disappears to Tarsus. Most historians and commentators say probably around 10 years. No church planted in Tarsus. His darkest period, most likely. Barnabas goes to Antioch. The results of the persecution are there, but these people have come to Jesus. And he gets a bright idea. I know what I'll do. I'll go and find my old friend Saul. Can you imagine that church meeting? I've got a new co-leader I'd like to introduce you to, with whom some of you will be distantly familiar. Saul. And the fantastic thing is that Dr. Luke doesn't say, wow, look at this. There is just outrageous grace being shown. Two things as I close. Ladies and gentlemen, let's be outrageously gracious to people who come among us. Anyone with me in that? We didn't get sorted out in 10 seconds, and we're still not sorted out yet. Everything is broken, every movement, every network, every church, every person. We're all broken under reconstruction. Let's give each other grace. Let's give each other space. We had a guy come to Timberline, gangster, 6'6" tall, muscles in places where I don't have places. His life message was tattooed on his knuckles. On this hand, it said you, Y-O-U. On this hand was another word beginning with F, not Philippians. F-U was his message. Little Marge, 3'6" tall and 275 years old, went up to this gangster standing at the back, rigid, angry. She said, hello, I don't believe we've met. He burst into tears, gave his life to Christ, but he still got these words on his hands, which was all right until he started raising his hands in worship. People thought, oh, unusual banner. But no one rushed to him and said, please remove these tattoos. They are now incongruous with that of a disciple. And the day came when we took an offering for the surgery, and he stood in the baptismal tank with little plastic bags on his hands because his hands were still healing, with little Marge sitting by the baptismal tank with a big grin on her face. And he held up his hands and he said, "Now the outside matches the inside. Let's give people space to grow, ladies and gentlemen." But I did say two, and the second is this: keep giving each other space. Go on. Because the biblical metaphor for humanity is sheep. And sheep aren't that bright. You might go to SeaWorld, but you're not going to go to Sheep World, are you? See, next time someone upsets you in your church, just say, it's all right. Sheep. It's just sheep. But listen, lean forward. But don't forget that you're one of those sheep too. Please, my new friends in the Salt and Light Network, keep loving each other. T.S. Eliot famously said, "What is life if we have not life together?" Keep doing it. Would you stand with me quietly if you're able, please? Would you stand with me? Pete, team, if you're... Thank you so much. Would you pray with me? Lord, we thank you for this healthy church in Antioch. It wasn't perfect, but we thank you that there was a confidence among them about their place in your plan. I would like to pray today, Lord, for this network, that the confidence that they have in the priority and value of church and being together will continue and grow. Lord, where some of us have lost our voices in terms of evangelism, as we see this church just gossiping about Jesus as they navigated life, give us our voices back, Lord. We don't want to become pushy, obnoxious people who read scripts with breathless monologues. And we don't want to be all about just words and no works and no wonders. But we'd like to get our voices back if we've lost them. Help us to encourage each other, to catch each other doing something right. And help us to keep passing the grace around. You have been so epically kind to us. You are amazing, Lord. We'd like to pass it around. Sometimes some of us say, "I don't suffer fools gladly." We're so grateful that you do. Because there's you in your incredible wisdom. And then there's us stumbling around. Bless you for your patience, Lord. Before I invite Phil to come back and close our meeting, would you look at me for a moment? Because I talked about suffering. Salt and Light friends, we can't have a theology of the supernatural if we don't have a theology of suffering. We've got to have both. We've got to have both. Otherwise, we just end up with an embarrassed cough when tragedy strikes. Some of us here today are suffering. And you can define what that means. And let no one say, well, compared with what others go through, you don't have to play that game. You know this is a rough time for you. Some of us here, this is a hard season. If that is you, I'd like to ask you to respond by doing absolutely nothing. Nothing. Just for this moment, nothing. In fact, all I want you to do, if this is a tough time for you, is to just take the weight off your feet and sit down. Right where you're currently standing. If this is a suffering time for you, it's difficult. Why don't you, as many others are doing, just sit down for a moment. Go on. Take the weight off your feet. Nothing more for you to do at the moment. Just rest in the weight of the prayers we're about to pray. Around you, you'll see people who are sitting down. I would like to ask you to go and not pray a prayer, not ask them why it is that they're sitting down. I'd just like to ask you to put your hand on their shoulder, symbolic of the hand of the Lord being upon them. Would you look around? Let's have a bit of holy chaos in the tent. Where you see people seated, just go stand. Put your hand on their shoulder. There's people everywhere, so make sure no one is left alone. And now, why don't you whisper your prayers of blessing that they might simply know the hand of the Lord on them now in this journey, able to bring them out with the miraculous, able to take them through with His grace and strength. Just whisper over them the hand of the Lord upon you.